Glory to God. Well, I want to welcome everyone to another one of our lessons on manifested success. We've been studying success from the viewpoint or standpoint or from the position that we are successful and that our success is in and through our salvation in Christ Jesus, that success and salvation in Christ Jesus are synonymous. Our Lord said, what would it profit a man if he should gain the whole world and lose his soul? That's enough for me. What would it profit a man if he was going to have a few things here in this life, or a lot of things here in this life, or everything here in this life, and then lose his immortal soul, be lost forever, for eternity? What did it profit a man if he was to live 120 years or 150 or 300 or even 500 years here and be lost for all of eternity? I just want you to think on that for just a second. Just divide, just take and do this. Go get your best calculator and see what percentage of eternity 500 years would be. Just divide eternity into 500 years. I think you'd find your calculator comes up short of the ability to do that. And any person thinking that any portion of time could compare with eternity is confused and mistaken. Salvation in Christ Jesus and success are synonymous. Living with God, living in the light of His glory for all of eternity, that is success. Anything short of that is not success. So we've been studying the fact that we are successful in Christ Jesus. And what we're looking at is how to get the success that we have in Christ Jesus manifested before a lost and dying world so that they can see the success that we have in Christ Jesus. We're not doing it to obtain the success. We have the success once we are saved. Once we receive salvation in Christ Jesus, we are successful. But we want to manifest that success out of a sense of love for others. We want to manifest that success the way God designed us to manifest the success, so others would be provoked to jealousy, envy, so they would ask us, whether it was out of jealousy or envy or just a desire to have what they see us having, they would ask us, how did you get such peace? How do you have such peace when everything seems to be falling apart? When everything is going wrong, why do you have such peace? And you can tell them, because I have salvation in Christ Jesus. I know that God loves me. I know that He will keep me. I never lose sight of the fact that my hope is in the Lord. It's not in the circumstances. It's not in my body. It's not in my bank account. My body might misbehave. In fact, it will, according to the scriptures. But I have success in Christ Jesus. Glory to God. So what we're doing is we're looking right now, we left off our last lesson, we were looking at the gospel according to St. Mark in chapter 11. We're looking at Jesus' example. Jesus had cursed a fig tree and the fig tree had dried up overnight. And people had, the disciples that were with him had asked him, or had marveled about the fact that the tree had dried up. And Jesus is going about telling them that they can do the same thing if they will have faith in God or have the faith of God. And then he tells them how to do it. Before we go into this, I just want to preface it by saying, it keeps coming up in my spirit, that as you go through doing this, you want to keep in mind that faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's a joyous expectation of good, a joyous expectation and anticipation of something happening that is good. I want you to see a scripture. We'll come right back here to Mark. We go over to the 145th Psalm. Psalms 146, the 146th Psalm. See, keep in mind now, we said faith is the substance of things hoped for. And we describe hope as a earnest expectation, an active expectation, a joyous expectation of some future good. Something good's going to happen. And your faith is in the fact that God said it, I believe it, I understand it, my hope is in him. And here in the 146th Psalm, I put a little check mark in here. We'll read verses 3-5, but we came over here for verse 5. It says verse 3, put not your trust in princes, nor in the Son of Man, in whom there is no help. There's no help. Nor in the Son of Man, in whom there is no help. Does that say no help? So if you're looking to another man for your help and for your salvation and for the things you need, you're being deceived. There is no help. The man couldn't save himself. So you don't look to me, you look to the Lord. You don't look to another, you look to the Lord. You look to the Word of God. Because according to the scripture, in man there is no help. A man can lead you and he can guide you, but my help cometh from the Lord. That's what we want to know. See, as we get ready to do this, that Jesus said, have faith in God, and we get ready to speak to the mountain and see it removed, we want to know that this is not coming from any other man, and it's not even coming from us. Our help is from the Lord. So now it goes on to say about man in verse 4, his breath goes forth, he returneth to the earth, that the days, in that very day, his thoughts perish. So anyone that is thinking, it says, anyone that's thinking and using this brain, it says the day he dies, his thoughts die with him. He doesn't use that brain to think with. It's saying there is no help in man. So we look to the Lord. Now the fifth verse is why we came over here. It says, happy is he that has the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God. This is where our hope should be, not in man. Don't put your hope in man. Your hope should be in the Lord. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for. So you can tell whether or not your hope is in the Lord. How do you tell if your hope is in the Lord? Because you're happy. Isn't that what it says? Happy is the man whose hope is in the Lord. Happy is he that has the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God. If you're not happy, who are you hoping in? Where is your hope? And you think you're operating in faith and you're sad? You're not operating in faith. You're just operating in a wish. You might as well be reciting the nursery rhyme. I wish I may, I wish I might, I wish I have the, what is that? I don't even know how it goes. The dream I dream tonight. That's not the way the children of God are to operate. Jesus said, have faith in God. If you're going to have faith, you have to have hope. And your hope should be in the Lord. And if your hope is in the Lord, you should be happy. And so you just put a check mark by that scripture. You give yourself a check up from the neck up. Don't lie to yourself and saying, oh, my hope is in the Lord, and you're sad. Happy is the man whose hope is in the Lord, who has the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord, his God. Is this clear? Does this follow? The faith is the substance of things hoped for. Then I need to have hope before I can have faith. If I don't have the hope, I have nothing for my faith to take substance in. Now, I don't have to wonder if I'm in faith or not. If I'm sad because I haven't even obtained the hope. Does this make sense? This follow? That if I'm going to have hope, I'm going to be happy, and I'll know that my hope is in the Lord because I'm happy in situations that should not bring joy. But the reason I'm happy is because my hope is in the Lord. So I check myself. If I'm sad, I'm not hoping in the Lord. Why? Because happy is he whose hope is in the Lord. My hope is in something else. It's in myself, in my own ability. It's in a man. And I just read that there's no help in men. I just need to get my own thinking straightened out. So then I can do what I can start. See, this is what it says, growing in wisdom, growing in knowledge, growing in understanding, growing in maturity. It's one of the things. I'm not going to deceive myself. I'm not going to believe that I'm standing in hope and I'm still upset. I'm still crying and weepy, saying my hope is in the Lord. Your hope is not in the Lord. Your hope is in someone else, in a man comforting you, or someone giving you something, or someone doing something for you other than the Lord, because if your hope was in the Lord, you would be happy. Just a little key. This is talking about growing up and maturing in the things of God. We want to get to a point of maturity that we can manifest these things, and he gives us time to do it. Let's go back to Mark 11. And we're talking about having faith in God, or the faith of God, as it says in verse 22. And Jesus said, for verily, or truly, I say unto you, that whosoever shall say to this mountain is representing something going on in your life that you don't want. This is not talking about us literally going out and finding mountains to move. For what reason and where would you move it? This is talking about things happening in our lives that we want to change. We want to manifest. So you can say unto this big, what would appear to be a gigantic obstacle or gigantic opportunity. It says, shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart. And last time we went over explaining that this doubt in the heart is not doubt in the head. It's not talking about doubting in your head whether or not you could say to a mountain, get up and move. It's talking about doubting in your heart, meaning that you're doubting your worthiness to have this happen, what you're saying, even though you had faith in God. This is the doubt that men need to deal with to start with. Self-condemning is what it's talking about. Without being self-condemning, well, I know I want that car, but I don't really deserve it because I know what I did Tuesday. Has nothing to do with your deserving it. It's all because Jesus deserves it. And we're in Christ Jesus. We have this ability not because of us, but because of Jesus. Let that sink in. It's not based on you. Get your mind off yourself. Put your mind on the Lord. Happy is he whose hope is in the Lord. Does the Lord deserve it? Yes. He's the one that made the sacrifice. And so stop being self-condemning. Stop putting this on yourself. Get yourself out of the picture. Quit having a pity party. I deserve it because of Jesus. Jesus died so we could live this life. God didn't put it on us. He put all of the punishment on Jesus so we could receive all of the blessings because of Jesus, not because of us. It says, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe those things that which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Now here's another part where people stop. He says, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass. This is where we were in our last meeting, where it says, believing those things which you say. The Lord tells us to speak the truth in love. Because here again will become a form of that self-condemnation where it says, oh, you're just lying. You lied all the time. You said you were going to do this, and you said you were going to do that, and you never did this, and you never did that. Believing, speaking the truth. And the truth is that even though you did all of those things, this is not based on what you did or what you are doing. It's based on what Jesus has done. Speak believing that this is going to come about because of Jesus. Get it off of you. And the best way to get it off of you is to stop lying. Purpose in your heart to tell the truth. We looked at that in Ephesians in the last hour. It says, speaking the truth in love. May grow up. Stop being worrying about suffering the consequences. Jesus suffered the consequences for you. Speak the truth. Get to the point where you believe you, so that you won't be hindered in your own prayer life. See, if you shall say unto this mountain, do you believe what you're saying? Why do you believe it? Because of Jesus, not because of you. It says, read it again. But whatsoever, for verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe those things which he saith, shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Now, here's one of the things when we're talking about how God made us, we're wonderfully and fearfully made. Faith comes by hearing. We believe we've got to the place where we're speaking the truth. We believe this. We believe this. We believe this. But we don't see it.